Hi, welcome to the GetsNatty Morning Show. It's me, sir. I was late. It's handling the dogs. My bad. How late was I? Hi, everyone. Sorry to keep you waiting like that. It's me, GetsNatty, my way into your hearts, 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Good morning, Maxine. How long did I keep you guys waiting? I was rushing. We just got to go live over here. Okay, let's get rid of Microsoft Climp Champ. Hopefully, wherever you're watching this, it looks better than it's ever looked. I upgraded for the output. Now we're outputting in 1080p everywhere. Hopefully, nobody gets downscaled. Hopefully, it looks better on Kick, looks better on YouTube, looks better on Twitch. And looking at clips. Some creep said time is irrelevant. Well, you know, the more we learn about physics, the more I learn about physics, Maxine, and, you know, astrophysics and metaphysics, or any kind of suffix you want to attach to physics, the more I learn about physics in general, the less I presume to know, because I'm a poet, if you see, not a great poet, but I have the mind of a poet, not the mind of an engineer or scientist. So it's a little above my pay grade. But one thing that has set me recently onto a path to look inward and outward, really, but looking inward to look outward insofar as like spirituality is concerned, which is something I've always ignored, is I've come across in a few places that that Hindu, particularly Sanskrit, ancient fucking Vedic or Dravidian mythology and whatnot, myth making, like really had come to a lot of conclusions that advanced physics, modern advanced physics, had come to, but thousands of years ago. So I just want to find out more. Not that I'm necessarily going to become a Hindu, but I'm going to start with Eastern traditions. Anyway, that's what I'm reminded with the whole thing of time being irrelevant. You know, at some level, I can cognitively understand, you brought this up, Maxine, here we are. At some level, I can cognitively understand that time and space are the same thing, but different things. Space-time is a thing. I can sort of conceptualize that. I can have someone explain to me what fourth dimensionality is, how that works, whatever that fucking symbol is, that shape. I could see and like, oh, yeah, it's interesting, but I don't know what the fuck's going on. You always forget time exists. How's that? Yet you live your entire life. I doubt that's true, John. How do you get anywhere? We all, whether or not time, the thing is, but it's like some physicist, here's like one of like the, if some physicist wants to be like, time doesn't exist, actually, it's like, yeah, fine. In a conceptual way, in the, you did bring up physics. In a conceptual way, time doesn't exist, but time fucking exists because I'll get fired if I don't get my fucking job in a minute. Like I have 70 to 80 years to live, 70 to 100 years to live or whatever. You know what I mean? My dog has 10 to 15 years. Like time doesn't sound that irrelevant to me, Mr. Smarty Pants Scientist.
It's all related to speed and light. And we just have started to count time as if it's like its own unique entity, but it's just literally a product of speed and light.
Good morning. Welcome to the GetsNatty Morning Show. We're explaining speed and light and physics and space-time. My dog loves space-time. My dog is an interdimensional traveler named Nina. Time definitely does exist. It's just relative to what you're comparing to. Well, thank you, Mr. Einstein, with your theory of relativity. See, that's about as complex as my, she says related, relative, and I'm like the theory of relativity? Hey. So that's fun. Hey, Richie Williams. So my name's GetsNatty. I'm GetsNatty my way into your hearts, as always. At 10 a.m. But and you may notice I am not, and this is crazy, I really truly feel like I'm without a net. I'm not streaming live on the Clock app. You know, let's, I don't want to do a daily thing about where we talk about how shitty TikTok is, but we're gonna do it for a minute. Like, I was looking for songs to put on a TikTok. Like, when I go on about, like, how, forget about my content, me as a TikTok creator, like, the actual content you watch on TikTok sucks now. It's not as good as it used to be. And the best example of this is, like, I tried to put Paint the Town Red by Nicki Minaj. I had a viral Instagram reel that did like 5 million with that song. And that did like 700,000 on TikTok. So it was like, oh, that was a cool TikTok. I'll use that sound again because it's funny. Can't use that sound. So there's all that Sony Music, all that sound you can't use. Half your old TikToks have no noise on them. Every other TikTok you see is selling you some cheap plastic shit or an ad. Or, you know, it's just not what it used to be. Or am I wrong? You know, I guess I'm talking to, you know, a few hundred people right now, none of whom are on TikTok. So I guess I'm preaching to the choir, but who is canceled? Is Nicki Minaj is canceled? Wow. And Taylor Smith removed her music. I don't know. Like, you know, where there's smoke, there's fire. It doesn't seem like, regardless of what the government's doing, it just doesn't seem like a, half the shit I see on TikTok is like hyperspeed sales. Yeah, you see a lot of QVC. And like, that's fine. I always say, I get that they're trying to monetize, but here's all I have to say about TikTok Shop. You guys see this Pokeball behind me? You guys see that nice little Pokeball? I love this fucking thing. I love that thing. They didn't pay for it. Some nice vendor sent it to me for free on the assumption that I would advertise it. So they sent it to me for free, and then TikTok prevents them from advertising on the show. You know what I mean? And if I were to advertise this, I would just want to be live with it behind me. And when people ask about it, I'd say, click right there. But if you have it live and you're advertising, TikTok wants to be like, this is my Pokeball. There's no other Pokeball like that. If you don't talk about it for 45 seconds, you get a little violation warning. So like, you're literally in some fucking QVC fucking sweatshop in fucking Harbin, China or some shit. Like, and that's, you know, fuck that. Anyway, this was called by Neon Spaces. Was by the Zoom. They're in Los Angeles. They're in Los Angeles, and it's great. I love it. Like Neon instantly. I gotta say, let me. Neon instantly raises the production value of your. I'm a streamer in his mid 40s setup. God, I'll tell you. Go around YouTube. Look at streamers in their late 40s, early 50s. There's a lot of these bobbleheads, a lot of these action figures. I'm not quite unique, I'm finding. It does kind of look like the Pepsi logo. Hey, I've never been a huge fan of Pokemon, but I know good logo making when I see it. And you are right, Maxine. The Pokeball does look more than incidentally like the Pepsi Cola thing, which for my money is one of the most iconic, let's take a look, one of those iconic logos of all time. Also, I want to try some new trick I learned on this thing. I can share screen more seamlessly. Look at this. This is the class. Oh, come on. You can't let me see that, you fucks. Classic. Here, we'll just share screen. Okay. Look at that. Oh, that's what we're going to share. So yeah, okay, it took us all this time so we could just say that the Pokeball looks like the Pepsi logo. Great job, Pepsi. Great job. What is it, Game Freak? Great job, Nintendo. I don't know about how the licensing works in the Japanese markets, but I think it was a Nintendo game. Apparently Game Freak's its own entity. I don't know. You make great games. I tried playing the Pokemon that came out on the Switch when it came out. It's a little too slow. Like the old school Game Boy Pokemon games where you just flip through the menus. You don't have to listen to all the fucking inane dialogue written for fucking, I don't know, 8-year-olds. It's so slow in the boring. I just want to battle. I just want to crew skills for my monsters, my pocket monsters. Thank you. I hope Shigeru Miyamoto is listening. Is he even involved in those games? I don't even know. You like playing Family Feud on the Switch? Now that sounds like a fucking hoot. That actually sounds like it might be fun live content. Okay, so now you're saying Pepsi is elderly old. Well, so is Coca-Cola. And I kind of defy anybody, stop sharing, kind of defy anybody to find a cola or a great soft drink that isn't elderly old. Mm. What's a get? Uh oh, should we get the phone live on camera? Okay, so we have this book right here called 1003 Great Things About Getting Older, which is a wonderful book. They could have stopped at 1,000, but they gave me 1,003. They had three more. Usually this joke, sometimes it'll give me a chuckle. Sometimes it'll say something legitimately dark. And sometimes it'll just be like a boomer joke that's too old even for me. But right here we have a joke I'm going to steal, and I think it's actually a really good one-liner that might be from the Far Side song, Ya Mama, from Far Side's Bizarre Ride 2, one of the greatest hip-hop albums. Nay, one of the greatest albums made in pop music ever. The Far Side's Bizarre Ride 2, look it up. Anywho, your mama's so old that when she talks, people call it oral history. Your mama, your mama, your mama. I turned it into a your mama joke, even though it's only an old joke, but I've just got such the comedic mind that I can fuse two jokes into one. You get that? Also, I didn't want the implication about myself. Another one, micro-targeted toward me, rather hurtful. Sometimes this book can be hurtful. You're ready to do character work in movies, meaning I've lost my leading man looks and I'm now a character actor. Well, thanks to rampant sexism and how we view the sexes, I don't think that's true, but oh. Okay. I've just learned some interesting news about, interesting news about Family Feud on the Nintendo Switch. Apparently on Nintendo Switch's adaptation of the popular American game show Family Feud, once hosted by Richard Dawson, now by whom? Drew Carey? Anywho, fun show if you've ever seen it. Also a fun video game adaptation. And on the video game adaptation on the Nintendo Switch, apparently if you get to a certain level, you play a family of cats in Family Feud. So the Nintendo's Family Feud game veers into a science fiction action adventure game, which is fun. Like Dead Mouse, but the count version. I don't know what any of those words mean, but they sound fascinating. Oh, Cat Lady Page, I'm wearing the shirt you got me today. I was admiring it. Oh, I thought it was a mug. I was excited. It's a camera? Candle?
It's a candle, yeah. Well, I got it for my mom for Mother's Day on TikTok shop.
Too bad we're not on TikTok shop. We have Pod Lady Page.
Lemon verbena, and then the container is really cute, and so is this little lid. But they're soy candles, which I've heard are a little better for breathing in. Lightning or smell?
When I smell it, I have two reactions. Yeah. What is it? Lemon what?
Lemon verbena.
Lemon verbena. My first reaction is, can I eat it? My second reaction is, this would make good soap.
Yeah. I like the container, though. I think it's so cute. It makes me think of
Billy. It smells really nice. My first reaction is eat it. My second reaction is rub it all over myself. So
I have to do a TikTok shop thing about it, and then it's for my mom for Mother's Day.
That's lovely. It's easy when the thing's nice.
It's different scents. So the top of it is lemon and orange. The middle is anise seed and lavender and herbs. And then the base is patchouli and cypress.
You should have recorded the natural, wow, when you open it. It's easy to advertise something when it's actually nice. Like this.
Like our little candies, our freeze-dried.
Those freeze-dried candies or the little pink tripod I always show on TikTok. Like it works fine. I'm happy to like. Show it to people. You can eat anything if you really want to. You can have a bite of anything, but you couldn't eat the entire. You can have a bite of the Empire State Building, but you couldn't eat the Empire State Building, unless we involved a shrink ray or something. And that's not going to happen anytime soon. Am I right? Imagine I was like that. So. But here's what I am like. My name's GetsNatty. I'm GetsNatty on my way into your hearts 5 days a week, Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. I can't stop. I won't stop. I wear reading glasses because I'm a man of a certain age. But you'll notice that on the back, some people call these like the granny chain. And I don't like to call it a chain because I don't like to be tied down. I like my freedom. America. But I don't call this a chain at all. I call this the young guy strap because I'm an active guy. Don't want to lose my glasses. I'm outside chopping wood. You've seen the footage. Bit of an outdoors type and very active. So I need this chain. So like, you know, my glasses don't, not a granny chain, cool young guy, handsome chain. Just so we're clear. Good morning, it's Andrew. How are you? I'm hoping that the show looks better than ever because I paid for more bandwidth.
I'm going to send you something. You should pull it up on your computer and like live react to it.
Email it to, email it to.
It's a Zillow property that's listed that's basically like a little artist community created by Katie from the B-52s and her wife, and now it's on sale on Zillow. But it's really cool. I thought it'd be cool for you to live react to it. It's like 50 Airstreams that are all lined up together in a community in California. All
right, we'll check it out. Alrighty, so my name's GetsNatty. I'm GetsNatty my way into your hearts. I'm about to check out a property in California owned by the B-52s, the band.
No, owned by Katie from the B-52s and her wife.
Katie from the B-52s. Okay, well, let me look at the
B-52s. They put it together, and now it's for sale for like $425,000. This property they put together is for sale. She was the bitch with the hair, you know?
The beehive?
The little... Like,
the blonde?
Yeah.
Okay. Share screen. Hi, Meemaw. I'm glad you're locking in on school. We'll see you soon.
Not the blonde. The redhead with the flippy, with the ends, you know?
Okay. A little here. This is $452,000. Okay, so it's a bunch of ghost shit. It's a bunch of buses in the middle of the woods.
It's a bunch of Airstreams in the desert. Okay, don't look at it like that. Just look at the pictures.
I'm just looking at the it's 10 acres. Residential built in 1955. Calling free spirit in the dreams. All right. Just make sure I got me over here. That's lovely. Wow. 4K.
Wait till you start seeing the insides of them. It's crazy. It literally looks like it was just ripped out of like the mid-60s.
Wow, look at that. That's crazy. Holy cow. You better really like the B-52s.
Well, it's I like cool this one. It's like a bunch of Airstreams that are livable. They're all a little bit different, but they're all still kind of themed.
I like this one.
Like you, me, Max, Tara, and Roxy, I'll move there. And Mima, I'll move there to
Is there internet?
The community. What?
Is there internet?
Yeah, I mean, you can put internet anywhere you want.
Fun. We'll love that. If we can get any other people, we can buy this little mountain, this little desert community of trailers that are pre-decorated. That's so fun.
Streams.
Gulf streams.
Airstreams.
Airstreams. Okay, I'm gonna take this off. Okay. Hey, Dens, how are you? How do I get this back? So, as we've established, I'm so old. When I talk, people call it oral history. Is that where Amber Heard went with her friends and slapped the shit out of Johnny Depp? Maybe. Maybe we could all go in on this little Airstream trailer lot in the middle of the desert with these cute little 50s. I'm on Zillow. That's cute. Airbnb would be fun to do with these. Yeah, it's kind of for foreign. The thing is, like, you see that if you've got the capital. My initial reaction, Lynn Sharp, is like, music festival. But then next thing you know, they're making a documentary about you. My favorite thing, speaking, you guys remember the Fyre Festival? That might be a Fyre Festival documentary view might be good for watch party. I may be able to make good content out of that. Oh, wait. Huh. I just thought of something. I just thought of a very easy way to record Watch Party. Never mind, but that's regardless. I just had a eureka moment. Maxine Laurel says that she'd love to slap Johnny Depp. Now, when you said, do you mean that you want to slap him because you want to hurt him because he's a bad guy? Or you want to slap him because you get some sort of sexual thrill from it? Because that's a valid question. the Fyre Festival, for those who don't know, some rich influencer guy. This is very like, this is like just before COVID maybe. I want to say this was 2017, even 2019. Some rich guy, rich influencer guy, rich parents, borrows money type guy, you know, jet setter. Good morning, Barbarity. He set up this music festival in the Caribbean somewhere, maybe the Bahamas, with some rapper. I don't even remember. They got a bunch of like hot Instagram baddies to come. So a bunch of like hot models are coming and like, you know, making it look like rich people, hot people, young people come to the Fyre Festival. You get this luxury fucking, you know, you get this luxury bungalow in the fucking Bahamas. Anyway, it turns out to be a total fucking disaster in their head. And there's a monsoon. It's a bunch of rich kids on an island eating fucking cheese on bread sandwiches and styrofoam. It was a disaster. Hey, Jared, how are you? Maxine wasn't, I wasn't invited to the Fyre Festival too. Now I could tell you, I'll tell you, if I had I been a Z-list influencer back then when Fyre Festival was going on, I guarantee you, while they were putting out invitations to Fyre Festival, I would have been like, why can't I go to Fyre Festival? And they'd be like, you're too old and too ugly and not cool enough. And I'd be like, I'm not too old. I'm very handsome and I'm very cool. And they'd be like, sorry, guy. And then when the actual thing happened and it was a disaster, I'd be like, I didn't want to go anyway. I knew it was failure. It's true. Did you hear about Grimes's shit show at Coachella? I did not. Not only am I incredibly out of touch, I'm also extraordinarily old. So it's a wonder that I go on TMZ once a month as some sort of guy to crack wise. I'm not crazy about either of them, but Amber Heard, I was talking this. At any point, I am willing to talk about Amber Heard and Johnny Depp as just a case study in how everybody's shitty. And you can kind of like, you could look at the Amber Heard and Johnny Depp situation and really get whatever you want out of it. Men's rights activists, sure. Feminist, sure. Look at these people. You know, like Amber Heard makes a great case for men's rights activists. Johnny Depp makes a great case for feminism. These two are fucking monsters. The shitting in the beds, the least of it. Ugh. What, so ugly. And I hated, like, a lot of time people were like, I just felt so gross anytime people were like, ooh, go Johnny, or even, ooh, Amber Heard, both of them. And if anything, on balance, and it's really not her fault, a lot of it's timing, but if anything, on balance, she probably got it a little bit worse, at least in the court of public opinion, than him. But, I mean, fine, because they're both fucking turds. You know, exactly. They're both rich assholes. And like being rich doesn't make them assholes, but doesn't not make them assholes. You know, it sometimes can intensify someone's asshole. Like Johnny Depp, I've read interviews with Johnny Depp. I remember reading an interview in Rolling Stone maybe 10 years ago, which this is before all this. It might have even been before he was with Amber Heard. But he's like, the interviewer's like, I've read that you spend $15,000 a month on wine. And Johnny goes, only $15,000? That's insulting. Now, here's the thing. And here's why if I ever get legitimately famous, I never want to do a print interview. Because he might have been like, I could have said that. And I would have been sarcastic. Only $15,000? That's insulting. Even if I said it in that tone. But if you say that while you get interviewed, they'll put it in print like that. And it would sound like if you're reading it, because this is how I read it, only $15,000, that's insulting. As if I'm entitled to that, you know what I mean? They're both dysfunctional. He's just funny. Yeah. He fumbled when Winona Ryder so big out. Shady, were we there? Were we where? You've been in relationships, haven't you? You don't know who fumbled what. Are you saying he should have let her go away because she is truly, I don't know, she's kind of underrated in terms of like timeless beauty. I would say, you know, and if in other cases, her like her notoriety. Remember in the early 2000s when she got caught shoplifting at Barney's or whatever. If anything, you would think her notoriety would enhance like the legend of her, and even her being in Stranger Things, where I thought she was wonderful, especially in the first season of Stranger Things. I thought she was. She reminded me a lot of my mother, actually, when my mom was frantic about her children, actually. It's so hard to know somebody through text. He could have been sarcastic. The only reason I'm like particularly sensitive to that is because I'm extremely sarcastic and I say like off the fly shit, off the cuff shit, off the hook shit even, but I'll do it in a voice so as to like demonstrate that I'm joking, but that you can't do that in print. That's, you just hear that over and over and over again, like never do an interview in print. Mostly from comedians. And I guess that's probably why. I remember like hearing Chris Rock say, never, ever, ever. Do a interview in print. Her performance in Stranger Things makes all people shut the hell up. You know, a lot of people are like, oh, she's shrill and annoying. It's like, yeah, that's the fucking point. She's beside herself. She's a woman who's missing her children. That's called acting. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, it's like, just people are weird. Like, another instance of this, and women are guilty of this too. You can cry sexism at this, and you know, I guess this would be a case of internalized misogyny. But like people talk about Skyler on Breaking Bad, like, oh, I hate Skyler. Like, but it's like that's the point. Her husband, but like she's doing the right thing. She found out her husband's a fucking meth dealer, and she's not okay with it. She's acting the way a person would. Like you dislike her because she's a foil to the main character, but the show wouldn't be interesting if you just had a wife who's like, okay, doopy doopy doo. Do you know what I mean? Like, so it's like oftentimes when people are like, oh, I hate this person, I hate that character, what they mean is that person's doing a great job depicting something. Sometimes they're just bad.
Skyler from Breaking Bad because she's ugly, but that also is a part of her character, is just being like the fucking screechy, whiny, like, you're not even that hot ass stay-at-home wife. The worst part of the entire show, I don't know if you've watched all of Breaking Bad, but when she does the happy birthday, Mr. President, for her fucking boss.
Oh, I don't even remember that.
You're lucky. You are fucking lucky that you don't remember that shit. The most cringe I've ever cringed.
That's like the point of the couple. And I think the show, for instance, I do think the show's a tad overrated. That show, people were like, it's the best show ever.
Have you watched all of it?
I love it, but I just don't think it's the best show ever made. I just think it's a huge.
In the last 20 years, it's one of the best.
Okay, fine. Just not the best. The thing is with that show, when they first started, you're talking about the Mr. President thing. They depict them both as like really nerdy, kind of like not basic, but you know, kind of straight down the middle, Randy Newman, not jet setting cool people. Now I kind of want to see that.
You really should look it up.
We'll just watch it right now. Like, we can even, you know what I can do now? I can make it so people watch me show the screen. Okay. Skyler Breaking Bad. Skyler Breaking Bad. Happy birthday. First hit. Ugh. It already looks gross.
It's so
bad. Probably not. No way.
Come on. Are you cannot fucking deny your employer's birthday wish.
Yes, can. Well, watch me.
Please.
If this is your birthday wish, I feel very, very sorry for you.
Oh, come on. It was so good last time. Come on.
It was ages ago, and I'm enormous now, and I don't look anything like her anymore. Not that I ever did. I mean, come on.
You guys, these candles are getting wax all over the place.
Seriously?
Yes, come on, Skylar. Skylar.
Skylar. Skylar. Skylar. Skylar.
Come on, Skylar.
Skylar. Skylar.
They could have queued it up a little better for me. A little sexy. She's a little sexy.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
I don't know if you're
to you.
She looks really good, actually.
Happy birthday, Mr. President.
Nina, would you chill the fuck out? I like breaking that. Okay, she's a baddie.
Happy birthday to you.
You have a boner.
I don't have a boner.
Yeah, you do. You gotta
do I don't that. Have a boner. I just think she was kind of attractive.
You're chubby.
It's not chubby. I was expecting it quick. What's 15 inches? What's 15 inches? I was quick. I'm ready. You got to deliver. Well, it's only 9:36. That's crazy. We've talked about the literal physical underpinnings of the universe. What is space time? We got the best joke that we're going to get out of this book, which is you're so old that when you talk, people call it oral history. I like that. Well, you must have been something during the Triassic period. Am I right? What's 15 feet in inches? 12 times 15? I don't fucking know. 120. It's 180. It's 15 feet, 180 inches. You're checking my ability to do arithmetic? Wasn't Skylar part of the pivotal lesbian couple on that show with Hal Sparks? Let's back this up. Hal Sparks was the host of Talk Soup with the skunk thing on his head, like the spot, and he replaced Greg Kinnear on Talk Soup, which is a really fun show. I was watching Talk. I was in on Greg Kinnear from the beginning because he hosted a show called Talk Soup. Then it became a movie star. It didn't quite work out the way I hoped it would for the guy, but you know, he had a nice career. I would kill to have his career. Well, who am I kidding? So good for you. I'd love to host Talk Soup, actually. Is that even still a thing? I'd actually probably be pretty good at that. Or I could just kind of make my own soup. That's not a bad idea, actually. 180, that is right, yeah. It's 10:37. What do you mean? Oh, well, Jared, I'm in a different time zone than you. I'm in Wisconsin. So for me, it's 9:38. I assume that means you're in on the East Coast. The city is so nice they named it twice. Love that for you, King. I'm going to, we usually don't take a break until 10:30, but I'm not going to take a break. I'm going to walk 10 feet that way. Ooh, wait, we have music now? We have AI music. Should I start putting AI music on this? Yeah, it's like this. No, we're not doing this. You're in Pittsburgh. Love that for you. Do you consider yourself on the East Coast if you're in Pittsburgh? Inquiring minds want to know. Hold that thought while I go film. Matt Damon. Hold that thought while I fill up my coffee. Never mind. We're going to talk. Matt, do you hear the music? I'm not mistaken. Oh, no. If I turn the music off. Off. Turn it off. The music won't turn off, people. Okay, there it is. Okay. The music is so disco. Louis C.K., Matt Damon, look it up. Okay. Louis C.K. is a comedian who I think is brilliant. I think his comedy is brilliant, but I don't think when people say he was canceled, I don't think that's fair. Like he the same thing that happened to Bill Cosby is what happened to him. He, like, it wasn't like a Me Too incident. It was like a horrible crime what he did. So when people say he was canceled, I just don't think it was accurate. It's like, no, he's a monster. But that doesn't mean I do love his. I won't act like I don't like his stand-up. I do. I just when people want to bring that up, I just don't want people. I just don't think. Why he's roasting him for 7 minutes? Oh, the thing about Good Will Hunting. I love that joke. Pepe, if you're talking about Louis C.K.'s joke about Matt Damon and Good Will Hunting, the joke is like, oh, so I'm watching Good Will Hunting, I'm pissed off. And it's like, imagine me, it's like, here's Matt Damon writing this movie. I'm a genius, but I don't even have to study. I'm just so smart. I look at math, I look at algebra, and I just know it. And it's just like, okay, that's right. It is like such, and I could see like the self-importance that an artsy kid, his parents were teachers and they went to private school. So he kind of grew up the way I grew up with like the, through friendships, anything is possible because you're a rich kid, even though he wasn't rich. He grew up among and was taught by rich kids. So he kind of did, and you know, look at them now. But that whole, with that whole kind of self-importance, like, who the fuck are you? Oh, you're a genius, huh? I mean, it's a joke. He was canceled. His show was canceled. His tour was canceled. He was canceled. Yeah, I just mean to, I think what happened there should be separated from the concept of like somebody saying something and getting, quote, canceled. He didn't say the wrong thing. He like actionably did horrible things. Like, I just think canceling, it just doesn't seem accurate to me. I don't, the same thing for like, for Bill Cosby. He wasn't canceled. It turns out he's a fucking criminal monster. Andrew, Jeffrey Epstein wasn't canceled. Fucking Prince Andrew wasn't canceled.
I think what's funny with Louis C.K. is like, for my generation, one of the only things we were exposed to of him that like really stuck with a lot of people, and mostly girls, was this random clip of him talking to like an 8 or 11 year old girl about like her self-worth and like how the world is and like how life will be for her, and like he says like some pretty inspirational or just like nice like wise things to her, and then like maybe 5 or 6 years later everyone was like, he's jerking off in front of his assistants.
Well, I, you know, what? People are complicated.
Yeah, it's... well, yeah, for sure. I mean, the dichotomy of man is, you know, ever surprising, but it's just very funny that like my only real exposure to him was that video of him saying stuff to women about like how to get by in the world. And really, to him, the only way to get by was just let him beat off in front of you.
Jared says, monster who requested to perform masturbatory actions in front of the people he did. Well, like, you're a big deal fucking comedian, head writer on a comedy show. You hire female comedic writers. And you're like, hey, you like this job for $4,000 a week? I bet you do. None of this is all inside. You're like, listen, I'm just going to pull my dick out and jerk off while we have this fucking meeting. At no time ever in 1950 with a different set of fucking cultural mores about how men and women treat each other, was that okay? At no point ever was that kind of behavior. Even if like a Ottoman Sultan did that, people wouldn't talk, he could do that and get away with it. People wouldn't talk about it openly. People would, like his servants and his staff would fucking cover for him. At no point, at any point, was that an instance that was okay to do that. Even in societies or cultures which allow for like men to be inappropriate or handsy, like there's just no way to spin that.
My thought is like, why wouldn't you hire prostitutes? You know, like how easy
would you can't get
do that?
You can't get in people's heads, and I don't even spend that much time. It sounds like I'm angry. I don't spend that much time being angry about it. There's a lot of monster. Like, oh, I get it, and I'm not going to sit here. Like, there's people who have been canceled rather unfairly, really didn't even say anything. That's not, and I'll be like, oh, that really sucks for them. And Louis C.K., even though I do, his comedy is also amazing. It really is. He's really fucking funny. But that said, I don't sit there going, oh, that was unfair what happened to him, because it just wasn't. It is kind of how I look at it. Also, without him, Pamela Adlon's career. Well, yeah, you know, we were talking about, I don't know, I just have never laughed so hard at a stand-up comedy. He's, Pepe, he's hilarious. I still watch his clips. I'm just, you know, it's hard to, if we had talked about if we had talked about Louis C.K. for 15 minutes and I didn't bring it up, I honestly think that would be kind of malpractice on my part, just not to be like, huh? I love Jim Gaffigan too. I'm really, really amazed how fucking funny Shane Gillis is. I've kind of discovered him over the last month or so, but Shane Gillis's stuff about, Shane Gillis is an uncle with Down syndrome, and his stuff about Down syndrome is, as someone with who's I have a sibling who's doesn't have Down syndrome, but who's mentally handicapped. It's just, people should watch it because, you know, like, one annoying thing about if you're someone who has like handicapped siblings, having other people who have not been touched by it, the issue at all, presumed to be the arbiter of what I can and can't say or what morality is. And when an irony is, like, you know, I'm someone who knows how to treat handicapped people with grace and as human beings, when the people who want to presume to lecture people about what's okay to say or how to say it would freeze up. Because, like, fuck you. Speaking of cancel culture and that kind of fucking shaming, fucking right-think behavior, I just get real fucking touchy when people presume to, like, oh, you can't say, I can't. Fuck you. Anyway, his stuff about, if you want to see what his comedy has to offer, look at his stuff about, not only is it, it's actually also kind of like, it'll put a smile on your face. It'll make you feel good about Down syndrome people in general. The whole crux of his joke, his uncle has Down syndrome. He's like, I've been around, my uncle's Down syndrome, has Down syndrome, been around a lot of Down syndrome people. Don't worry about Down syndrome people because they are fucking happy as fuck about everything. And it's just really funny and kind of uplifting. I'm just saying, you know, people act weird about shit and it's annoying. We don't have to be all weird about it. Pamela Adlon. Yeah, Pamela Adlon was on Louis' show, Lucky Louie, was it? Which was okay. His show also, like, speaking of his, I love his stand-up, his show, Louie, that was on FX for years, it's like he's making one week he's doing Francois Truffaut, and the next week he's doing Chekhov. It was brilliant, brilliant filmmaker, brilliant guy, just, you know, not the first very talented person who's also a monster. Bye, Maxine, it was good to see you. I mean, you know, John Lennon was a wife beater. Womp, womp. My name's GetsNatty. I GetsNatty my way into your hearts 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. This morning I posted a video, a clip, a 1 minute clip of the show where I was going on and on about Little Miss Helen Keller. You love going womp womp? I do too. Womp womp. I wonder, it seemed to have entered the lexicon in a big way maybe a year ago today. Literally your favorite thing to do is womp womp. One of my favorite things to do, and I wish I could more, is, you know, that's what she says. This is really juvenile, but I hate being in situations where there's just like a layup. That's what she said. I'm like, I guess that makes me like Michael Scott. I was trying to eavesdrop on our phone conversation. Your literally favorite thing to do is go womp womp. That's crazy. Womp womp compilation.
Okay, so then if I'm understanding correctly, your company purchases data from other companies.
Oh, Paige is going to get into it with a Paige is getting into it with a telemarketer, I think. You also say that's what he said to me. Well, I'll do a that's what he said when it's appropriate, Andrew, instead of a that's what she said. Obviously, of course. Of course. Of course. But sometimes when like it's the opposite action, sometimes when like you reverse it a little bit, it can be funny. When it should be a that's what he said. Down syndrome is up with people. So true. I also have a soundboard with a classic womp womp sound. How do I, hold on. Let me just Google something real quick. Restream soundboard. I was gonna switch to another app for streaming all my stuff that has a sideboard that has a Restream soundboard that has like an in-house soundboard, but it didn't. Okay, it's just not working. We'll have to figure that out another time. Namaste. Is it womp womp? No, it's not womp womp. Sometimes I like to, I take a step back. Womp womp compilation. Ooh, hold on. Online soundboard. Let's see if this works.
That game. No. No fuel horn.
Bitch.
Jamie, I really want my ace back. I really miss it.
What? This is the worst video I've ever seen. I'm really sorry. I want to apologize on behalf of the internet, on behalf of YouTube, on behalf of Google, on behalf of TikTok, on behalf of myself, on behalf of the writers of this dumb book, 1003 Great Things About Getting Older, for the worst TikTok. We need some quality control, TikTok. That was Gen Alpha brain rot type shit. What the hell was that? I was like watching fucking, I don't know. You ever turn on Cartoon Network like at 8 in the morning? It's like some fucking, fever dream, some fucking psychedelic fever dream, like reaching the spirit world and some shit. Oof. Hold on, we got to plug in our phone here. Wow, look at that, 3,000 people watching on Instagram. How'd that even happen? Jimmy pooped, our dog.
He's walking around so weird. Oh. He didn't want to. He didn't want to poop out there. He thought it was naughty to poop on the concrete. And then he looked at me.
I've never been so happy to watch a dog shit on video.
Look at him. There he goes.
Oh, he's in slow-mo.
Yeah, he slowly is like, oh.
Our dog Jimberly or Django or Kimberly or Tim Burton, as we are prone to call him. He's been having a little bit of a problem with the pooping outside thing, that concept. But Paige just caught him on camera.
In 4K, shitting outside.
He caught in 4K bricking on the patio.
Out there for an hour.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's the only way to, like, don't.
When you're forced, dude, you're forced to stay outside. That's life now.
Yeah, the only way for him to shit outside is to just leave him outside till he shits.
I mean, Squanto's like the same, but she knows not to poop inside. She'll piss on anything.
She'll, as soon as, like, oh, you're not letting me out, she'll piss, yeah, but she won't poop. She'll hold her poop, but
she's like, we do not shit in this house.
Oh, you didn't walk me? I guess I'm pissing.
Yeah.
Hey, Jess Joe, how are you? Good morning. Hey, thank you. Shady Grove congratulates you, Jimothy. Pass that along, please. He'll love to hear that. So also our dog Jimmy's got really really kind of basic taste in music, not in a bad way. Like he just likes he likes Jefferson Starship a lot. He likes, you know, nothing's gonna stop us now. So it's fun. Oh wow, those of you on Chatterby, you can barely see me. I'm the worst, huh? Look at that. Okay, look at that. Look at that. All three. So should we read maybe leave that on outside? What, put the show on outside for him so they can hear us praising him. Jared, you're watching on YouTube. I just did something, so hopefully this show looks better than it ever has and will continue to look, because I'm spending more money on bandwidth and I'm now outputting this in 1080p, even if it's getting down. It's the video's weak sauce. Jared, the resolution's bad. That's too bad. Or are you talking about weak sauce, the womp womp video? Hey, Jess Joe. A thousand and three great things about getting older. You'll never have to buy another refrigerator. Well, gee, there's a fucking dated book, because I'm 47 years old and I've literally never bought a refrigerator. I don't think I'll ever have to. I, you know, even if you buy a house, they usually come with a refrigerator, right? Fortunately, you're now too old to remember having your braces tightened. I remember trigonometry. I never took it because I was dumb. So fuck you, dumb book. Climbing a spiral staircase in a miniskirt. What I looked like at the prom, I didn't go. What your first time was really like, I remember. Sucked. Drinking until you threw up. Oh, Pepperidge Farm remembers. Not caring if your hair got wet. The name of the one your mother wanted you to marry. It seems like most people can remember that. Do y'all like Panera bread? It's fine. Panera is overpriced, and the
Panera, I miss it so much.
The food's good, but I found it overpriced.
It's literally like a food co-op where it's like only worth it if you work there and you can like order your fucking rations.
Ooh, we should let's go to that other food co-op today.
Okay.
Just for shits and gigs, to, you know, we need coffee anyway. Big excuse to go out there. Hey, Zadarzy. Panera's way overpriced. The food's good. I remember getting this like roast beef sandwich at Panera, roast beef, whatever. This roast beef horseradish, something that sounded delicious. I get it, and the sandwich is delicious, but it's about the size of a dildo for someone who's like kind of modest about what they can take. Kind of the size of a dildo that of someone who's not looking to impress anybody. And it was like $12. Now for $12, I wanted to be the size of a dildo that like I doubt anyone could ever get it inside of them. That size dildo. Is Panera sandwiches only? No, it's like bread. It's like a glorified Starbucks. It's got like lunch food, like soups and sandwiches type deal, and bread and bakery stuff. I may or may not have secrets about Panera. Just say the secrets. What is your secret? And they better be good if you refer to them as secrets. Moderate dildo is accurate, right? You know what I mean, Shady? Like it's like of a you know that like bread I'm talking about. It's like a moderate, like, okay. Nina, would you please stop whining? It's like 6 inches, not too much girth. Like you're gonna know it's there. Being able to use a dildo as a size reference for a sandwich is a beautiful facet of the English language. Nina, you really got to calm the fuck down. You're so annoying. You have no idea how annoying you are. I swear to God. My comments are not coming through again. Yes, they are. It might be because, Paige, it might be because we're talking about dildos and stuff. Hey, keep all those dildo thoughts right there. Dildo sizer. Small, medium, and what the fuck? Okay. I'm sorry, my dog is freaking out. I'm going to take a break. I'll be right back, guys. I just gotta fill my coffee. We're gonna talk about Panera. We're gonna talk about dildos. We're gonna talk about all sorts of fun stuff. My name's Gets Natty. This is the Gets Natty Show. Back after this. That would have been more dramatic if it went. And we're back. Oh, no. I left my coffee upstairs. When I see Paige again, I'll have her hand it to me. Okay. So before we left, we were talking about how Panera is overpriced. And now I had once had the food at Panera is delicious, but it's overpriced. I once had a sandwich that a roast beef sandwich, which I remember was being delicious, but it was like $12. And it was about the size of a dildo. But like the dildo of somebody who's not trying to impress anybody, this is a dildo they have to get off. It's like, you know, 6 inches, like regular size. Not like, and for $12, when I got a roast beef sandwich, I want to be the size of a dildo that someone shouldn't be able to fit inside of them. That's the size dildo I want my sandwich to be. Yeah, so Panera overpriced. And we're going to stop talking about Panera right there. That's it. That's it. The final word on Panera, it's overpriced. My comments weren't going through, but when I was younger, there were two ladies at my church and their names were Billy Mom. But more dildos. But more dildido. Panera is hella overpriced. Let's talk about hella. Is that like a California thing? We don't, I notice more and more Gen Z cross. I keep seeing people, Johnny's super Gen Z. Johnny's Gen Z out of his gourd, and he's saying hella. And I see it from other, is it a regional thing or is it a Gen Z thing? It sounds like Northern California to me from the 70s. KT Dancer hates hella. It just seems weird to me because we just don't say it. Like hella the. It just never makes sense in a sentence. Can we watch the sex drive dildo scene? We can. Let me send me a link and I'll queue it up. Didn't we watch that last week, Paige? We can't just do sex drive clips all the time. I might have to make people watch clips of Airplane. Ooh. East Coast Gen Z, I say hello. Okay, so Andrew confirms that it's become truly just a Gen Z thing. KT Dance, are you Gen Z? That's someone who hates it. Okay, we're watching a different clip of Sex Drive. It's a really funny movie. Fine, we'll watch the dildo scene. Sex Drive dildo. Sex Drive dildo. Would this get me taken down on TikTok if I just went Sex Drive dildo? Dun 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 dun. Sex Drive dildo. Dun 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 dun. Sex Drive dildo. Dun, 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 dun. It's really not coming through. I think like my safe search is off. Sex Drive dildo. Dun, 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 dun. No autocomplete. Is it a donut?
Six free donuts for the Banditos dozen. You're welcome. Sorry.
I like that outset.
Excuse me. You know where the gap is?
It's just past the movie theater.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, real funny. Oh, that's the whole scene.
Felicia.
Was that the scene? Oh. So for those of you who couldn't see it, it was a man in a taco or donut full-size uniform, like a mascot at Disney World, except he's dressed as a taco. And then he has a dildo attached to him. That's fun. Jared Mannering, I have no idea what any of those words mean, but sure. Oh, it goes on with him walking around the mall. Okay, it's just one of those jokes that gets funnier as you go along. How do I not remember? All I remember that about that movie Sex Drive, and incidentally, I live near the Amish right now, but all I remember about the movie Sex Drive is that it was about the last... what do you even call that movie? What would you even call a comedy like that? They used to call it Kevin Smith. You guys know Kevin Smith? He referred to like movies like Porky's. He referred to them as teen titty comedies, meaning it's like a dick and fart joke thing. And there's boobs with irreverent humor. They kind of don't make much of that kind of humor anymore. Everything got fucking, what's his name? Bo Burnham. Can I just say, I don't like, he's talented, but ew. You know what Bo Burnham's energy to me is? Here's the kind of energy we're not about at the Gets Natty Show. We are not, you know when Gal Gadot and all the celebrities sang Imagine? You know that? We try to be the opposite of that. We try to be a break from that, which also means we're not going to talk about the fucking election on this fucking show. But yeah, so we try to be the opposite of that. We can talk about people dressed as tacos walking around a mall in a dildo. Imagine there's no heaven. Hi, I'm hey guys, I'm in my mansion. I'm loving this this lockdown. Doesn't affect me because I'm a millionaire that my fucking job is gone, but I'm gonna sing this song written by a millionaire. This song Imagine, I'm a huge John Lennon fan, but you know, first of all, the premise of the song is really stupid. It sounds fucking like a horrible place to be, but also keep in mind, this is a man who had a separate room in his fucking condo at the Dakotas on 72nd and Central Park West. This was a man who had a separate room in his fucking luxury condo for what that was set at a different temperature to keep his fur coats better. So yeah, imagine there's no heaven, no religion. Everyone's equal. So that's the guy who wrote that. Had a separate fucking room. And I love John Lennon. I literally... I always say Paul's my favorite Beatle, but John's probably a bigger influence on me as a musician, just because I'm also like a rhythm guitarist. But you know, yeah. Had a separate room for his fur coats to keep it a different temperature. You know, it's whenever people like that are lecturing you about how to go about running your life, or how things should be fucking divvied up, be suspicious. That's something your friend Karl Marx really had right. Daddy, would you like some sausage? Daddy, would you like some... Whoa. What is up, Texas? Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. I've literally got a separate room for my fur coats that I keep at a different temperature. It's easy if you try. Where can I watch the Sex Drive movie? The movie Sex Drive, I have no idea. I would have to imagine it's streaming. It's from like 2008, 2009. It's funny. The girl who in it, it was the first time I saw her. You guys see, I love the show Silicon Valley. Do you know the girl who, she worked for the VC? She was like the hot girl who did it. She didn't end up dating anybody. She's like the hot girl who worked for the VC, was like, who was their like ticket to like the world of like finance. You know, the hot girl on the show, who was like the main character for the whole time. Anyway, that was the first movie that's the first movie I saw her with, and she's great. And if you haven't seen that, the show Silicon Valley, I highly recommend it. One of the funniest jokes in that show. I had my first photo shoot this weekend, meet porners. Oh, you've never been, Texas, is it like physique lighting? Because if it's physique posing in a physique photo shoot, I could use pointers from you. If it's like just standing and getting photographed, which I'm actually not terrible at, I've been told. It's just, you kind of want to like be natural and don't be making faces. You want to be as dead in the face as possible. And then emote as directed. But you kind of just want to be, there's a great thing when being photographed, kind of just be always kind of be slightly in motion. You want to look natural. You don't want to look rigid, but in terms of physique, I'm sure there's nothing I can tell you about downlighting and or oiling yourself and or water expulsion that you don't already know. I think you'll be fine though. But yeah, the movie Sex Drive, really funny. But it's like, John, if you're gonna watch Sex Drive, there's a lot of irreverent comedies from the 90s too. Which would probably be fun. A Cronut Dildo, what is this going on? What's going on? What's going on? I've lost control of the chat. They're talking about Cronut Dildos in the chat. What's going on? I mean, there's Airplane. I don't know. Like, have they made a movie as funny? Did comedy die in 2000? I don't know. Because the Hangover movies were funny. Horrible Bosses movies are funny. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe around the last... you'll be all right. It doesn't pretend, either pretend you're nobody or you're like, or you're Elton John, text. You know what I mean? Natty, read my comments. I'm reading them. He has sausages tied to his fingers playing the piano. Freddie got fingered. Yeah. See, Pepe, there's a video. There's these guys called Red Letter Media. They're some of my favorite people on the internet. In fact, one of my biggest dreams as a creator, help me make this happen, somebody, is to get on Wheel of the Worst, to watch Best of the Worst with the guys at Red Letter Media. They always talk about Star Trek. I love those guys. They're middle-aged nerds who are like my age. They talk about Star Trek. Of course I love them. But they did a deep dive on Freddy Got Fingered, and one of them is like, no, it's actually brilliant. And the story behind that, according to one of them, it's like, it's him like literally trying to waste the studio's money. And when you kind of see that and you see how he literalizes it, it's actually a fascinating movie. Pepe, look up. I'll show you this. I'll just put it on so other people can find the video. Red Letter Media. Freddie Got Fingered. And it's almost like worth watching. It's not a good movie. To be honest, it's not a good movie. But it is like a curiosity. That better it. Media. Very Channel much. We talked about this with memory for an hour. It's very much. KD Nancer says comedy's not the same. No, I think it's back. I think it's okay now. Like everybody, like around 6 months ago, I feel this as a creator. I do. I definitely do feel this as a creator. Comedy's back. You can joke about anything. No one cares anymore. People who are a pain in the ass about everything, everyone's like, yeah, they're a pain in the ass. You know what I mean? So I think it just takes it like media is downstream of culture the same way that, that politics are downstream of culture. It just takes a while, like for the, like the, you'll start to, I guarantee you in the next year or two, you'll start seeing, I hope so anyway, more irreverent humor. Just a vibe I get, just from what I see, however in touch I am with like the mood of people. I think comedy's back. I watched Everything Everywhere All at Once with my mom this past weekend. As a Chinese person, it feels so relatable. Movie hit so hard. I have not seen it yet, but I'm actually really fucking fascinated by it for a couple reasons. One, because it's about time travel, which I always love, but I also love, I forget her name, but she's also in Star Trek Discovery as the bad captain from the mirror universe. Is it Michelle Yao? Anyway, I'm excited about that movie. Also, because as you say, it's a Chinese person, it's relatable. Just how a lot of that like stuff with time and space and how that relates to Eastern religions, including like Chinese folk religion and stuff. I'm pretty fascinated by Sable or Gable, either one. I have no idea what that means, but I'm excited to watch Everything Everywhere All at Once, to be quite honest. Guys, I have to run for 12 seconds to get my coffee. It's Superwoman. Paige John, thank you.
You know you left it upstairs.
I know, yeah. I was like, guys, I have to go get my coffee in a minute, but I kept putting off, and now here we are.
How are your shoulders and your feeling today?
Good.
Mine feel good, but it's like as soon as I put them up to the side like this, and I feel it like in my shoulder caps, and I'm like, okay, please, I can't.
I mean, this one's still a little exacerbated, and my lower back's a little exacerbated, but I actually feel better than before I did the work yesterday. Well, so as I said, Red Letter Media's deep dive into the movie Freddy Got Fingered. Now, Freddy Got Fingered, we'll watch the trailer. Just I don't think I really like gave you guys a let's go to YouTube. Wait, are we still sharing the screen? Okay. Freddy Got Fingered trailer. Now, Tom Green is a name you just don't see anymore. Paige, I can't check Insta DMs while I'm streaming, or maybe I can. No, Cat Lady Paige. No, there's so many pages. Okay, official trailer, Freddy Got Fingered.
It's yours, hop in. LeBaron. Bet your boots, it's a LeBaron.
Look, it says number one son in the license plate. That's me, I'm the number one son.
It's not easy.
Imagine
if go.
It gets natty show, they proud. Put it on.
You hear me? I'm gonna make you so
imagine
proud.
If they put my show on MTV. Every night, kind of what it was, but 1998.
Get the hell away!
His humor's a little
now,
different, but it was like
excited
this,
about starting to work like, at the sandwich factory tomorrow.
Hello, can you hear me?
There's probably people at the factory that have been making cheese sandwiches their entire lives, and they're gonna look at me,
and they're gonna call me a loser.
You can't hurt me.
Cheese sandwiches.
Cheese helmets.
Hello.
He couldn't handle the complexity of making a
bad
cheese sandwich.
That's not Rick Taylor, back home. But the movie's like incoherent.
Look, I found a treasure.
That's soap on a rope.
Are you imbecile?
Oh no, the treasure! It went into that underwater cave!
He thinks different.
You want to just barge into a restaurant and expect someone to give you a TV show?
I don't know. Yeah?
Hey,
He talks different.
Come on, backwards, fast as you can.
Another backwards, man. The backwards.
Cat Lady Page, you really, really should watch that that Red Letter Media video.
And he acts
different. There's a couple scenes in this movie which are out of hand funny. You've never seen anything like this. I wonder if they showed in the trailer. The baby on the umbilical cord getting swung around?
He is.
I wasn't expecting that to happen. You man the bone, pathetic loser!
Is this your dad?
That's my bone!
Regency Enterprises presents Tom Green.
He's a stupid!
Not stupid!
He's a stupid!
Not stupid!
He's stupid!
Oh, there's Julie Haggerty. We were talking about her the other day on the show. She's the girl from Airplane. She plays his mom.
Freddy got fingered.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I still have some work to do.
Gosh.
Daddy, would you like some sausage? Daddy, would you
this
like
is
some
what,
sausage?
Hey, everyone's like, what was the world like before 9/11? This is what the world was like before 9/11. I couldn't really put it any better than that. Okay, Freddy got fingered sausages song. Hey, those of you watching on Instagram, it should be obvious to you that this is why you should be watching on Kick, on X, on YouTube, on Facebook Live now, streaming from Facebook Live. Why not? Where else am I? Twitch. Freddy got fingered sausage scene. Okay. Really, if I was going to show one clip from that movie, it would be the Daddy, would you like some sausage? All right, we'll do the short version. It would be the umbilical cord scene. Where is it? Freddy got fingered sausage scene. Okay, sure.
Freddy got fingered promo, take one marker.
Do you like
the commercial?
You can't hurt me. Not with my cheese helmets.
Do you like sausages?
Daddy, would you like some sausage? Daddy, would you like some sausage?
A wheelchair! You like a rocket power wheelchair?
Look at her go!
We want you to go to the movie.
He looks so young. He was married to Drew Barrymore for a year. While he had testicular cancer while he was married to Drew Barrymore. It was actually a fascinating, I like Drew. That he had testicular cancer.
And like any of what you just said, like imagine if I just pointed to some rando on the street and was like, oh my God, he was married to so-and-so.
Well, the only people know he made like a comedy special about his, like at the time he made Tom Green, he made a comedy special about like his getting an MTV comedy special about like getting his ballectomy.
Ew.
Is that what it's called? And like she was with him.
Celebrity people, I was like, who gives a shit? Everybody gets ballectomy.
But it wasn't like Kardashians doing it. Like the whole point was that it was like tasteless and weird. It was a joke. It wasn't like I guess of course it's like look at me, but it wasn't like. Yeah, but I understand your point. But his thing was like, if anything, commenting about shit like that in general, because it was really, really irreverent and weird in the way all the Tom Green shit was. Do you remember the Micro Machine guys where the guy was talking to you? You mean fucking John Moshita? Who listen? Oops. Find yourself somebody who loves you as much as fucking network and movie executives loved John Moshita in 2005. Oh, let's get the guy that talks fast. We'll put him in everything. So for those of you who don't know, and keep in mind, they don't have like a replacement. We didn't replace this guy. The subsequent generation saw fit that like, we don't need a guy that talks fast. We're all filled up. Thank you. We got AI now. So John Moshita, for those, he was also in a little thing called Transformers the Movie as a Transformer named Blur, for those of you who don't know. But we'll do a Micro Machines commercial. This is a guy, I guess he's still alive. Micro Machines.
What the
service station, and more.
Okay. Perfect. Wait, talks
portable to take any place, and there are many miniature playsets to play with, and each one comes with its own special edition micro machine vehicle and fun fantastic features that miraculously move. Raise the boat lift at the airport marina, man the gun turret at the army base, clean your car at the car wash, raise the toll bridge, and these playsets fit together to form a micro machine world. Micro machine pocket playsets, so tremendously tiny, so perfectly precise, so dazzlingly detailed, you'll want to pocket them all. Micro machines and micro machine pocket playsets sold separately from Galoob. The smaller they are, the better they are.
Aww.
My brother just sent me this. I'm like, bro, what?
It looks like a Gen Z meme to me. FMK, old school, Bill and Ted 3, Freddy Got Fingered. That's a great question. That's tough because a lot of apples and oranges there. It's an apple and orange and a coconut. Well, I could talk at length about all three movies. Bill and Ted 3, for those of you who didn't see it, you're Gen Xer out there, you remember Bill and Ted and Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. Two good movies, the second one's better. Turns out the third one is exactly the movie it needs to be. It's not like you're not going to watch it and be like, wow, it's like Godfather 2, but you're going to watch it and be like, wow, that really delivered. And I cried. I cried at Bill and Ted 3. I did. Yeah. I watched it on an airplane, but not that it did what it was supposed to do emotionally. I laughed, I cried. Like, it very much delivered. It was as good as it needed to be. It was like, you know what I mean? It wasn't like, it's not like you're, like, it feels like a Bill and Ted movie, but with heart and whatever. So I saw it on an airplane. I was so, so pleasantly surprised by it that I almost want to, of those three films, Old School, Freddy Got Fingered, and Bill and Ted, because those are three different things. Because Old School is just like a comedy that delivers laughs in a way that they don't really do very much. It's a comedy that delivers laughs. Bill and Ted 3 is that, but it's also a satisfying sequel that has some heart. A movie that's way better than it has any right to be. The idea of redoing Bill and Ted with the same guys, but now they're like in their 50s, and they're it's these same two idiots like contemplating middle age. That shouldn't work on paper, but it did. And then Freddy Got Fingered, which if you watch that Red Letter Media thing about it, where they talk about it, like literalized in the plot of Freddy Got Fingered is Tom Green, he's a cartoonist and he goes to LA and he convinces a studio executive to give him $1 million to make his cartoon. And the story of the movie Freddy Got Fingered is him wasting the money that the guy in the movie gave him to make the cartoon. But it's also nod, nod, wink, wink, him wasting the studio's money. Like, they gave me this money. That's why there's a clip of him flying a fucking helicopter and dropping a boat onto that's what the movie's about. It's a literal joke. It's very Andy Kaufman-esque. And now, like, I would say watch that, or at least kind of watch enough of that little thing, what he's saying, to internalize, then watch the movie through that lens. And then it becomes fucking fascinating. And then you really start appreciating, because there's moments in that film. That movie's incoherent. It is extremely off-putting, and it's tough to sit through. But mixed in through it, I'm going to have to put the scene. There's a scene where they've got a fucking fetus on an umbilical cord in a maternity ward, and they're swinging around. It is out of hand. Let me find it. Freddy Got Fingered baby. Hey, trigger warning? Freddy Finger baby scene. Freddy Got Fingered baby scene. Okay, thank you, autocomplete. Let's do this. Okay, people. Not for the squeamish. This is not for the squeamish. Nina, please stop. Please, you have to stop, Nina. Okay.
Baby inside your body.
Nina, please. Nina.
Little fellow.
I can't do a show if you're squealing. Just you wait. This is horrifying. This is a studio movie from 2001.
You gotta cut the cord.
Yeah.
Body in a way that he like squeezed in the air and fucking fell on the concrete on his face.
That's crazy. Is he okay? Oh my God. Studio film. Studio film. This movie was a box office fucking disaster. That's, you get it. Wait, I'm sure something else horrible happened. Maybe not. Okay. You get the idea. So, like I say, they say like that's a different world. The world's it's a different place. Like, yeah, I don't know what to tell you. You saw that show. That was crazy. I hope that was. Oh wait, why can't I see the chat? Okay. So, now, ladies, I'm curious. Do you think he was out of? Do you think Drew Barrymore was out of his league? They were both, you know, in their mid-20s at the time. I think Drew Barrymore is like 2 years older than me. So 2001, she was, I don't know, 24 or something, 25. Good for him. He was. My mouth is literally open and I'm just staring at the screen. Yeah. Mina, please. He had a talk show every night, which was, you know, it was just him and his friend Glenn. He's a Canadian guy. He had a Canadian accent show. It's actually a lot like Wayne's World, except that was in Illinois. But Nina, you have to stop. Tom Green had a public access show in Canada, and Drew Barrymore in 51st Dates. Yeah, that's the Drew Barrymore he was dating. She was, you know, movie starlet. Very, very cute. Nina! Looks, no. Celebrity, yes. Well, are you saying like he was such a big star at the time? He was. Like Tom Green was huge. And really it's after, I don't know, like Tom Green never stopped being funny. Why did he go away? And I still see him on stuff sometimes. It's weird seeing him. He looks like, I've always felt, I don't know, if you know who Tom Green is and you remember him, does he remind, do I remind you of Tom Green at all? Because at the time, even though I wasn't like, I was a musician, not really a comedian at the time, or not even I'm a comedian now, but all I did was like music in terms of art. People often were like, you remind me of Tom Green. Never heard of him, but then again, I was born in 2005. Yeah, no, he like literally just, he dropped off the face of the earth in 2002. And it was like he never existed. I had like pretty much forgotten about him until I saw a year or two ago. Even if you don't know who he is, it's an interesting clip. They were married for 2 years, him and Drew Barrymore, and they hadn't spoken. And there's a clip of them meeting each other for the first time in 20 years. It's really lovely, actually. Two nice people who seem genuinely glad to. I like seeing real moments like that. That's one of the reasons I like reality TV. And it's and even like, Nina, you have to stop doing that, please. Sorry, even like having. Even like having been able to like share real moments like that. Nina! Nina, come here. Sit down. Sit. Good girl. Sit. Stop whining. See, now I look like a big jerk because I have to yell at my dog. Does she have to use the bath? No, she's yelling about the other dogs freaking out upstairs. Nina, please stop whining. It like literally like makes my skin crawl and it makes my audience's skin crawl. You have to stop. People don't like that noise. It encourages people to action. Tom Green started doing stand-up in 2010 again. Mina, you're gonna eat weed. Shut the fuck up. Jesus. You have to yell at Lucy when she whines like that too. Well, it's just like, you know, there's no like solution to your problem coming, dog. So I wonder, is his stand-up any good? Because I don't remember him doing stand-up. I'd quite frankly rather watch him do a talk show like he used to. Lynn, do you remember, because fine, Chagrin just said, I don't remind them of Tom Green, but I would have to think people, at least people who were around with Tom Green, I would imagine anyone who likes what I do would probably also like what Tom Green does, just because sometimes it's it was the dead moose jump that got him whatever 2000s version of canceled is. PETA made it a big deal. You know what, Goose Jim? I just don't think so. I think that was a big deal, but it didn't get him canceled, because I remember in 2000, and like the idea of like anything being canceled by anything was like whatever. And the idea of PETA canceling anything was fuck PETA. It was like, it was perfectly okay to be like, you didn't worry about it. I'm just speaking from experience. In 2000, no one gives a shit about, even in 2014 fucking Tumblr insanity, no one gave a shit about offending PETA. But no one definitely gave a shit about offending PETA in 2000. Are you kidding me? Like a badge of honor. But even in like 2014 fucking stereotypical, the worst cancel culture fucking hellspawn ever kind of vibe, it was kind of okay to talk shit about PETA. I don't know. I don't hate that PETA serves a purpose. I guess it's good that there's people who are freaking out about the ethical treatment of animals, but you know, we also got to eat meat, but I don't resent them for existing. Anyway, I think it was wildly popular. In 2001, Freddie Got Fingered came out in 2001. That was expected to be a hit. He was still big. We all just kind of got sick of his shtick, or they just stopped putting him on TV. Maybe Goose Jim, you say, maybe he got canceled because someone behind the scenes with power didn't like what he said about PETA. But the people who run Hollywood are monsters. And yeah, they care about money more than anything else. If they thought Tom Green was going to still generate the money, you know, I think they would have put him out there. So I just don't think what I genuinely think about Tom Green is that he went away and nobody cared. Maybe the energy vibe. The only reason, Chagrin, that I would say that there's crossover between whatever appeal I might have and Tom Green's is that sometimes I deal in irreverent, absurdist humor. And in some ways, like, Tom Green's an influence of mine, to be whether I acknowledge it or not. Because I do a fair bit of, you know, my bum is on the chair type. Content, especially like when I don't know what to do. Speaking of Louis C.K., who is a, you know, monster, but also, you know, a good storyteller, he did this great thing. He did this episode about how he did a couple episodes on his show about him getting like groomed by the networks to do a talk show, to be like the next Jimmy Kimmel, to be one of like a late night host. They're like, well, you got to lose weight, you got all these things. So they have David Lynch as like the studio executive, who's like really just vetting him. Like, are you going to be the next Johnny Carson? And it's David Lynch of all people with his weird hair. And David Lynch is like, okay, be funny. And Louis starts doing his bit. And he's like, no, be funny. Don't say anything. And he's just like, and he just had Louis. And I've done this before in like an acting class. And I actually was like, oh, that is something I can do. But just the ability to like, when someone's like telling you to be funny, like, okay, just be fearless and be like, and like usually you resort to that. Tom Green does that. I do that too. So that's why I would say, I don't know why I'm showing off. And I hope nobody clipped that, because it was wildly embarrassing. You know what I mean? There's a bit of that, whatever that is. Like, we're not doing Ibsen here. Though, we like Ibsen. And we like, you know what's really underrated? Chekhov. If you like Woody Allen movies, read some Chekhov. Put on a production of Chekhov. Hey, there must be some art students, like theater kids here watching, theater college students or whatever, actors. Put on a little production of Uncle Vanya. You know, Uncle Vanya's a fucking banger. Uncle Vanya sounds so boring. But if you want a pithy, fucking fun, real funny, fucking little little thing, little play to adapt. Uncle Vanya. Also, I think Uncle Vanya is where the phrase Chekhov's gun comes from, but I'm not sure. So yeah. So here today on the GetsNatty Show, we talked about PETA. We talked about Chekhov. Andrew, theater kid, read some Uncle Vanya. I always wondered where, I know Woody Allen's a name that like everyone hates, but he made a lot of good movies, and I don't know if he's a monster or not, maybe he is, but he made a lot of good movies. His biggest influence as a writer is far and away. It was like, wow, when I first read Chekhov, it's Chekhov. So I would start with Uncle Vanya. It's funny. It's legitimately funny. It's not like, you know, when people are like, oh, Shakespeare is so wonderful. I'll say it. Shakespeare sucks. I mean, it's great. I understand it's important, but I don't have a good time fucking reading Shakespeare. I'm sorry. And you know what? I'm an intelligent, very well-read person. I'm just going to say it. If you like Shakespeare, great for you. I find it laborious and a bit of a fucking chore. I couldn't think of anything I'd rather do less than sit down and read fucking Richard III. Are you shitting me? Now I'll watch a production of Richard III or whatever, and I'll enjoy it, but, you know, come on. Lame. So I understand. It might sound like when I'm telling you to read Chekhov, you hear the Russian name, and it's like I'm telling you to read Shakespeare. No, no. Uncle Vanya is light, fun. It's great. And I'm sure it's been adapted into a million movies, plays, just without anyone saying it. Like, oh, it's an Uncle Vanya ripoff. But really, really, really funny. And one of, like, you know, I was fortunate in college. You know, like, I was an English major in college in the early 2000s. So, like, I actually, like, know a thing or two about, like, critical theory and postmodernism. Like, I studied in it at a pretty good university. And like, I don't regret my education at all. It was fascinating. And I learned a lot. And there's a lot to deconstructionism and postmodernism and critical theory and intersectionality, yada, yada, yada. The problem is the philosophies animating the social sciences, there's only one. And the only thing allowed is postmodernism and deconstructionism. And that cannot be the animating philosophy of a society. Why can't it be? Well, look at us. We hate ourselves for one. I think we're the only civilization in world history that hates itself. So that's fucked up. We have like an absurdist. We have in the White House. What's going on in the White House today might as well be a short story from the 50s written by a this is what postmodernism is. And your story, your postmodern absurdist short story would be about a 80-year-old president who's senile and a lot of the population being like, no, it's fine. It's like literally like a postmodern essay. And like, we can't be surprised by these things. And there's all sorts of postmodern absurdities that you see all the time. And like, it's not an accident. And I'm not saying everybody needs to fucking be into Jesus. I'm not saying that at all. But like, just look around you and like, can we stop being fucking crazy? But that said, I hate when if someone wants to think like I'm delegitimizing a school of thought. I'm not at all. I'm not at all. And in fact, like I value the education I had. In the social sciences, as the social sciences all realize today that I'm complaining about, I don't regret anything I learned, but it cannot be the only animating philosophy besides social sciences, especially if you're going to pretend that social sciences are hard sciences, especially if you're going to start like acting as if you're the arbiter of fucking truth, then no, you can't be the only one. Sorry. And like, this is important. This should matter to everybody. Because this determines our future in a lot of ways. And like, you know, this is the underpinning of a lot of issues. How do you want this world to be 1,000 years from now or 500 years from now? It should matter to you. I don't know. It doesn't matter to us anymore because we're so nihilistic. And most people don't think beyond their grandchildren. But you know, shouldn't you be thinking about, I don't know. The phone's ringing. Well, my name's GetsNatty. I GetsNatty my way into your hearts 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Sometimes I come on for a little like, you know, a little like impromptu crazy show at night, but sometimes always. We're pretty much toast after 200 years tops. I don't know. People love to. One of mankind's favorite things of all time has been. Let's just say, for instance, sake. Let's just say we're Rome right before the fall. We're not. If anything, we're Rome right before the fall of the Republic. So, which means there's a lot of runway in front of our life cycle. It's probably more accurate that we're the late Roman Republic, not the late Roman Empire. Regardless, even if we're the late Roman Empire, let's say we're Roman 400 AD, 70 years before the actual, what they consider the fall. And the fall of Rome was only that a German was then named empire. And then the Roman Empire kind of withered away. It didn't just like fall. But anyway, like even if you were like someone who lived like, let's say we are, Rome is about to fall. It's not like one day passes. And it's not like a month from now after like the actual fall happened, like people still had to go to work. People who lived in Italy around Rome were still Romans. Do you know what I mean? Like people have always had a need or like a, well, the world's about to end. It could, maybe because it's a nice, there's the, part of the whole death wish thing is that it's kind of a relief. Well, if the world's going to end, that means I don't have to worry about fucking getting my tax bill together or yada, yada, yada. But I think when people are like, oh, we're cooked. Even if like the most calamitous things happen, humankind is going to go on. Even if there were like a global thermonuclear war killing, 80% of the population, 90%, 10% is what? 100 million people? Yeah, we'll be fine. And like people want to talk about like the United States, particularly this hemisphere, as if it's on the way out. No, we're not. In fact, the arrow is pointed up for the Americas in general, especially compared to the rest of the developed world. So I don't know. Like but that's the whole thing of like we have this society that's animated by a lot of self-hatred or hatred of our own culture and yada yada, where it's just like, oh no, we're almost done. We're not. And like, I don't know. And when everyone acts like it's almost done, you're really short-selling future generations. If everyone's acting like, oh, well, it's all going to end anyway. Well, what if it doesn't end? What's your fucking great grandchildren going to do? So can we have a little optimism? The world's not going to end. People have been going on and on about the world ending for literally fucking 5,000 years. Hey, the heat wave we got this year speak for itself. Okay. If the world ends, Blockbuster can forget about getting their DVDs back. Yeah, but that exactly right there. When Austrian psychiatrists talk about the death wish, maybe that's what they're talking about. Maybe the part of the collective death wish or whatever it is the like relief of not, as you say, not having to return their DVDs. Gosh. Things, we always go on, there's this book, 1,003 Great Things About Getting Older. One great thing about getting older is the dissolution of the concept of video stores and late fees. Do you know, like, I was lucky, we grew up, like, well-to-do. I grew up, like, very firmly upper middle class. But I remember there being video stores. We couldn't go to because we owed them like $800. Like that's the thing, like a video cassette before they like mass market them. Like let's say you went to the video store and you rented Mr. Mom. That's one of the videos that we owed a lot of money on. Mr. Mom, really good movie, by the way, Michael Keaton. We rented Mr. Mom and my dad lost it in the back of one of our trucks or whatever. And we couldn't go there. And it was like $120 retail. Yeah. And they'd call you. And like their whole business was really predicated on late fees. So anyway, we don't have to worry about that anymore. And now there are no more video stores. My friend's parents ran a video store. I wonder I hope they landed on their feet. I'm sure they did. They were smart people. Incidentally, the store that my parents, we couldn't go to was owned by one of my best friend's parents. Small world. Hey, Kelly, it's good to see you this morning. This has been one of the craziest shows ever, and I'm really excited. Today, I changed a little bit of how I'm streaming. So if you're watching on Twitch, on YouTube, on Kick, etc., I'm hoping it looks better than it usually does. Oh, it's okay, Kelly. You can check out the replay later on YouTube or whatever. It should look better. But Paige and I yesterday did a lot of garden work. Paige was working on her patio, and she discovered that her patio, which was grown over, has this whole concrete thing that she uncovered. We uncovered. So we did a lot of landscaping work yesterday. And I'm nice and sore. It feels great. Maxine has never seen a blockbuster. I believe it. It's been a while. Well, I'll tell you. I lived in Los Angeles in 2005 and 2006. I helped with the patio, just so you know. And I did shovel, do all the wheelbarrows. I did help. I'm strong. I'm a big, strong man. But in 2006 in Los Angeles, I lived there, and I would go to Blockbuster here and there to buy DVDs or whatever. So there's that. But how could you, have you never, Maxine, are you really from, you say you're from the UAE? You're from the UAE and you speak perfect English, but you've never, if you're from the UAE, that would make sense. You've never seen what's it called? Blockbuster. Absolutely, Paige. Send me a DM. Well, maybe I'll share it if I can. But yeah, so Blockbuster Video. I don't know. I had this conversation in my Discord. Oh, by the way, on my Discord, we're doing a Star Trek watch party tonight. I'm so excited about watch party tonight. On my Discord on Tuesday, we watch Star Trek. On Thursdays, we watch Trash Reality. Tonight is Star Trek night. We're doing our first episode of Star Trek The Next Generation, which is why I started this. We're starting with an episode from season 4, actually, which is just a really nice pilot for the show that introduces everybody. And I'm so excited because I'm so excited to evangelize Star Trek The Next Generation to women because it has such like feminine energy. So I'm excited for that tonight. What is the reality show on Thursday? We don't know. Last week we did Sister Wives. We watched an episode of We Need Something Really Trashy. I agree. Sister Wives is great because I don't feel bad about pointing and laughing. So we're gonna do something trashy. But yeah, tonight on Watch Party, we're doing we're starting Star Trek The Next Generation. We're gonna blow through that over the coming weeks. Is it like Star Wars because I couldn't finish the first movie? No. Star Trek is nothing like Star Wars, actually. Star Trek's more about like talking and problem solving, not like action. Keeping Up with the Kardashians, we started with that. We need more trashy than that. The first episode we ever did on Trash Reality Show Watch Party was a season 15 finale where I was like, I had missed like a good 10 years. I was like, wait, they divorced, but Scott's still around. I'm like, oh, that's kind of nice, but he's a dick. I have kept up with the Kardashians here and there over the years. I won't lie. Okay. There's only 7 minutes left. But I do have to take a 4-second break just to get some coffee. Super, yeah, super trashy, Lynn. I'm with you. Like, trashy, trashy, because I want to be able to point and laugh. So tonight on our tonight on Watch Party, we're going to do the first episode of Star Trek: The Next Generation. the episode we're watching tonight is usually, it's someone in my personal life, if I want to show them, get them into Star Trek, this is the episode I start them with. Season 4, episode 10. So that'll be tonight. Do the pups love bubbles? I assume so. So if you want to know how to join my Discord, DM me on Instagram or wherever, or just subscribe to my TikTok. My TikTok is getsnatty.com. Subscribe to my TikTok and get a link. It's a $2.99 one-time fee. Hey, Rohan. So tonight, so excited. Star Trek The Next Generation is my favorite show. This is my favorite episode. And I generally judge people as to from whether or not they like the episode when I show it to them. If I show it to someone they don't like, it's like, oh, you don't pass the test. I'm just kidding, of course, but it's great. And Thursday night, we could do Jerry Springer, You're Not the Father show. We'll talk about it in the Discord, what show to do. Maxine Laurel says, I wish she wishes she was Irish. When you say you wish you were Irish, Maxine, do you wish you were of Irish descent, or do you wish you were native to or a citizen of the Republic of Ireland or Northern Ireland from the United Kingdom? Because I'll tell you, Maxine, I am of half Irish descent. And it's actually interesting about, the Irish were very much under the heel of the English. But since the Irish have left Ireland, they've ended up in a lot of verbal fields. Like me, maybe. I don't know. But I'm half Irish, and it's okay. Oh, you don't have to be. I'm half Irish, Maxine, and I don't say arsehole. So you can just say it. But I think when you say you wish you were Irish, that means you could say arsehole, and that was just the way you said arsehole instead of saying asshole. You know what's let me tell you guys something fun. I don't know if I should bring this. I don't know if I should unleash this information to the world. But if you're in an argument with a girl and you want to up the ante, there's one insult that's worse than the C word. I'm speaking strictly in American English. I don't know if this translates. I'll even extend this to Canada, but I don't know if this translates into Britain or Australia or South Africa or New Zealand, but I'll speak for America, States and Canada. There's something worse than the C word. Asshole. She's an asshole. Don't be such an asshole. Yeah. You know, women never get called assholes. Try it. Julia Roberts is an asshole. It just sounds shocking. Mother Teresa is an asshole. There's a case to be made for that. I'm a Catholic and I can see things on both sides, and I want to sanctify her, and she should be, but you know. Can somebody confirm or deny my thoughts on asshole, or am I just the world's biggest jerk? But would I rather be the world's biggest jerk or the world's biggest joke? My theory is that calling a woman an asshole is more offensive and hurtful than calling a woman a C word, because we typically don't use, we always use asshole to refer to dudes. Like, he's an asshole, never she's an asshole. That's why when you call a dude a C word, like, he's a real C word. Why am I afraid to say it? I wouldn't say it. I would say she's a C word. I can say, here's what I feel, what's proper. I make my own rules. It's okay to say she's a C word and he's a cunt. But when you call a guy the C word, it just hits harder. Same with asshole. And it's just a theory. And nobody seems to be in a hurry to agree with me. So maybe I should drop it. What a way to end the show. Kelly Noyens, you know what I'm talking about? Wouldn't it just be weird? Or maybe I'm wrong. It's not that it would be offensive. It would just be, no one would know. KT Dancer doesn't agree. You think, let's say you dropped it in an argument or whatever. Maybe people would be like, why? Why are you calling me an asshole? It's just too weird for it to hit. I love calling men whores. He's a whore. But it might not hit that hard, because most people might be like, what? I do remember, the only reason I thought this is because I remember complaining about a girl who did something, like broke up with me or went, didn't like me the way I liked her. This was years ago. I remember complaining about a girl to one of my exes who I was still friends with or whatever. She goes, well, she's an asshole. And I was like, wow, you're right. She's an asshole. I just remember being so delighted because it seemed so like, because she was an asshole, actually. You know, all was fair in love and war, but she was an asshole. But my ex said that to me. She's like, oh, yeah, well, she's an asshole. What are you going to do? She wasn't even saying that, like, because she was exacerbated or, like, tired of talking to me. She's just like, no, you gotta understand. She's just an asshole. But I always remember, the delight I felt because it seemed so, like, when she used that word, I remember the delight I felt because it seemed just so irreverent. I don't know. S-O-U-T is worse than C-word or asshole. Really? Well, is it... Yeah, I mean, you know why? I guess I could see that, Lynn, because like so much, especially like so much for women and like in like social interaction, so much of it's about like reputation and stuff and like just implying. See, that's something that's so interesting. And you have Maxine being like, yep, that's so true, Lynn. Like, that's just something like the wall, as it were, between the sexes. And like, you know, I've always been someone like, I like genuinely like women. I like unironically like hanging out with women as like friends. Like I like women. And even then I'm like, oh, that's such a surprise. And I have like three sisters. And even that is like, I'm amazed. I never knew that. And it makes so much sense. Now that Lynn was saying that it's worse to call someone or be called a slut than it is to be called a C word or an asshole. And then Maxine Redder's like, yeah, yeah. And I'm like, yeah, it's just like, it just wouldn't, if you're a dude and someone calls you a slut, it's just, okay, or whatever. Whether it's true or not, like even if it's untrue. I grew up in the country around a bunch of men, so it wouldn't be offensive if I'm an asshole sometimes, but that might just be me. Love that. I don't care what the person's gender is when I'm cursing at them. Yeah, but I mean, like, you know, our the language, you know, a lot of our language is gender coded. That includes argot, or is it called? Is it argot or argot? There's a great book if anyone's ever studied French. Even if you've only taken French one, it's worth looking at. It's a book called Med, which is all about French slang, which is all about the word shit. Every like thing in French slang is like shitting it up. Shit, like they use shitting, like the way we use fucking as like an auxiliary verb. The way I use fucking, all like if I don't have to worry about you know, offending anybody, I would use the F word a lot. But in French slang, which is very robust, more robust than English, some would say. I don't speak enough French to know whether or not that's true, but really the French use the S word, shit, the way we do, way we use the F word, but even more so. I find it so slay that I feel like people who say suck my dick the most often are people who love them. Yeah, it's funny when chicks are like, suck my dick. S my D. Yeah, it's just funny. Oh, we have fun. Well, you know what was a lot of fun today? The GetsNatty Morning Show. Every day I have more fun than the last day. And I'm really excited to look back at footage. I'm hoping it looked good today because I spent extra money on the bandwidth, and I changed how the stream works. I was going to change software, but I was like, eh, I like how the chat works here. So just keep this over, just make it look nicer. And so another smashing show. I hope to find some great clips, put them on TikTok. We get bigger and better every day. Hopefully we get funnier every day. Thank you, Lynn Sharp. Thank you, everyone. I'll see you tomorrow. And I don't know. I have a backup TikTok account. If you guys want to hear me sing, I have a backup TikTok account called GetsNatty Radio, I believe, which is in TikTok jail, but I'll be using that later, possibly to sing songs on the ukulele. I don't want to do music lives on these because I don't want to muck up my algorithm. And I don't want one single person who's like, oh, I thought this was a talk show or porn to be like, I don't want music. So yeah. Okay. But I love you guys and I'll be back later. You know, Monday through Friday, gets Natty in my way to your hearts. You know the deal. And I'll see those of you in the, I'll see you all my peeps in the Discord. And I hope to see everyone. If we're going to have so much fun. Uncle Vanya by Chekhov. Vanya. Chekhov. Uncle Vanya. Great play.